please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
Welcome back. As Anuj was saying, 72.3 on the rupee. The rupee is not getting any dearer. It's the dollar that's getting dearer. And likewise on the stock markets as well. A spot of bother with each passing minute bringing us closer to the 11,500 mark. Our technical expert has said he would watch for yesterday's low, Friday's low, which was 11,491. So we have to wait and see if that gets pierced. Then maybe there will be more of algo selling or people who perhaps early morning bought the dip, finding themselves running for cover. But let's wait and see. One of the things bothering investors would be the domestic mutual fund industry and its inflows in August. While the industry itself has crossed 25 lakh crore or 25 trillion rupees, the August inflows are a 19-month low, with net inflows a shade under 6,000 crores. A. Balasubramanian, CEO of Aditya Birla Sun Life AMC, joins us now. Good morning, Bala. Thank you very much. We still think of you as the AMFI face as well. So wear both hats, even if it was the previous hat. Sure. What's your sense? Is this now getting a little worrisome?
Well, not too worrisome. I think anyway we go through the cycle every now and then. I think since April, if you see, the trend has been coming down.
Yes.
In terms of net inflows, August was actually worse than the previous month, and August also has seen some inflows into the some of the mutual fund schemes in the form of NFO collections. There are almost about close to about 3,500 crores of NFO collection came. At the same time, SIP subscriptions continues to be on the rise.
Rise, yes.
So where we have seen some bit of redemptions, not so much on SIPs, where people have actually been invested for quite a long period of time. So we have seen some redemptions coming in the lump sums. So generally, we look at another ratio. The redemption ratio is versus the gross sales ratio. So gross sales is actually a true reflection of sales. Redemption is actually also some indication which is there. The net comes actually is the flows. While the net flows is good, the redemption gross sales versus the redemption ratios have been actually going a little up. Okay. But this I see it's a function of one, the market volatility, and second is fortunately the month of August, as you rightly said, the market touched a new high. Therefore, the element of some set of people would be thinking about, let me just book my profit and move somewhere else. Okay. So this I think is a function of that.
So basically you're saying that this is just profit booking that you're seeing, because if you look at the ELSS flows data, it's down almost 31%. I mean, in the month of August, it's about 650 crores.
Yes.
But on an average, in the past 3 months, May, June and July, it's been about 900, 950 crores. Would that worry you? Or as you said, it's just redemption after a good month?
No, on the contrary, if I see, ELSS flows have been pretty decent.
Okay.
I think there's people who have been wanting to invest in for the purpose of ATG benefit. They seem to be doing it right from the first month of April. Mm-hmm. So I've seen actually that inflows into the ELSS schemes is pretty decent.
Okay.
But having said that, ELSS schemes only get so much as against the large pool of large cap funds and mid cap funds, multi cap funds focused.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore, it's, the inflows in other schemes have been relatively lower than what you have seen in the past trend.
Okay.
And other point which is there is with respect to the convictions.
Mm-hmm.
Again, if you deep dive into the market and go down to the retail flows, have been actually higher than the, which is about less than lakh of rupees investment.
Mm-hmm.
They have been much higher than the what we have seen in the previous.
So what is your own survey suggesting? Are investors open to stopping fresh investments or redeeming SIPs because of various catalysts, you know, negative macros, etc.? Or will the positive trend continue?
I mean, the way we see is positive trend will continue for one simple reason. The effort that is being put by the asset management industry in increasing the awareness among people for investing in mutual fund has to be for long term. That will keep widening actually. I think it's now it's more and more new people are now beginning to accept mutual fund is one way of investing in the in creating form of wealth. So that actually segment is coming.
Okay.
Those who have come in the form of HNIs or maybe people with relatively 5 lakh rupees kind of ticket size, for him he sees a look at, he looks at the return. Second, which of course which is more unique to for this financial year or maybe this calendar year, I would say, the large cap funds with respect to the index, there is this gap in terms of
performance.
Because whole, as you know, as it is known, the whole market is driven by four or five stocks in terms of performance. Rest of the markets are not done well. That actually now beginning to reflect on performance
of
money managers, the index. So therefore, we are in that transition phase where adjustment seems to be happening.
I'll have two follow-up questions on that. But can we pick up the previous plate that our team was showing? The July inflows versus, of course, life high, which was last year, I think, about September, December. And average, you know, we took the average 2018 flows.
Yes.
Even compared to that, look at the fall in equity. It's fallen by half, 50%. Therefore, I'm asking if, you know, there is a bit of a conviction worry, or, you know, especially in mid caps.
Yeah.
So do you think it will be a, you know, some a factor that we will see continue to play in the second half?
Yeah, actually, I look at this a little differently. Okay. 2018, rather the previous year, 2017, was an exception year in terms of flows coming.
Yes, of course.
So I always consider, I always say that...
That is the outlier.
The peak inflow that industry has saw per month was close to 30,000 crores.
No, this is the average versus 2018. I mean,
correct.
We have not taken January, December.
Yeah, sure.
Okay, we have only taken Jan to March and if you... Jan to July.
Yes.
And then compared it with August. And August is 50% lower than the average.
Yeah, I think, again, we break this into further down. Where the outflows happened is mostly into the balance fund. And second is the arbitrage fund. And the pure equity funds, which is mostly diversified equity funds, where there is a drop. But the drop is not as significant as actually what we are, the 49% number what you are showing.
Okay.
So even last month also.
Yeah, I agree. So ARP funds are 10% of total equity mutual funds.
Yeah.
So a fall over there will
It'll definitely have an impact on that. Correct.
So what about some of these mid-cap, these small-cap funds, I mean, which are included, you know, in many of the diversified funds, the small and mid-cap names. So far this year, the Nifty mid-cap is down almost about 8-odd%.
Sure.
Do you fear that there could be some more money moving out of these funds just out of the kind of, you know, sell-off that we've seen?
Doesn't seem to be, for one simple reason, that mid and small cap space not seen the kind of inflow that was seen by the diversified equity funds, both in multi-cap and large cap category. Therefore, we may probably see a slowdown continuing in terms of flows coming into the mid and small cap. And though mid and small cap, all of us feel that is beaten very badly, and therefore the worst is over. Now, from here onwards, mid and small cap, I think, could perform better as the result starts coming on. But I think the general perceptions towards that segment, having seen the fall in the recent past, the flows may stay low, but we don't see an outflow coming in, given the fact they've never seen the kind of inflow that
I guess August, there was a 6% rise in the mid-cap and small-cap fund, small-cap index, so maybe some confidence returns. But will it go away in the bond markets, in the bond funds? Or fixed income funds, Bala, ILNFS has come as a nasty shock to the investor community.
Yes.
Are you going to see some severe reverses with funds, some fixed income funds being out of pocket?
I think the ILFS, yes, definitely is a shock to the whole financial systems. I think our belief is if it doesn't get resolved in the next few weeks by pumping in money into the ILFS to manage the liquidity, it could potentially have an impact not just only on mutual fund, whole financial system in general.
But what
at the end of the day,
the
exposures in the mutual fund, what they hold aggregate, is roughly about 7,500 crores.
7,000?
Roughly 7,500 crores. That's the report.
Across
number.
All funds?
Across all funds.
Okay.
And within that, if you see, some of the exposures are in the operating companies, and some of them are exposures actually the ILFS, which is the AAA or AA plus rated companies.
And the exposure to banks?
The exposure to the banks, I think the general reported number in the what is being circulated in the industry is about anywhere around 60,000 crores kind of debt.
60,000
crores of debt.
60,000 crores.
Which is the number which says. Mm. But of course, are all backed by assets, etc. Mm. So though per se, there is no issue with respect to their assets quality of the ILFS per se. But I think what is currently they are going through the pain is actually the liquidity mismatch.
And what about exposure of NBFCs? Would you have any idea to non-mutual fund NBFC exposure? Will there be any?
Of course, each one will have some exposures, though it's not the public domain, so difficult to give the number. But of course, one has to accept the fact that ILFS has been a AAA rated company for a long period of time, except the recent downgrade AA plus. He's one of the companies that's got about last 15
DB
years.
DB now, ICRA.
Yeah, that's right. Therefore, that actually came as a shock definitely on a Saturday when he saw this news. But one good thing on a mutual fund, which we have established over a period of time, any assets which gets downgraded has to be reflected in the portfolio in the form of value reductions.
Okay.
So we actually use the valuation metrics and there's a straightaway value reduction happens. Therefore, from the mutual fund industry's point of view, while of course the assets is there in some mutual funds portfolio, But the value being reduced using the valuation metrics. Therefore, from the investor's point of view, one doesn't need to worry. Except, of course, the liquidity may not be available immediately if somebody wants to sell. But at the big picture point of view, I think we look at it from the financial market point of view, as well as the whole banking system point of view. This issue was never expected by the wider segment of the players.
Sure.
Therefore, need to get addressed as quickly as possible in order to ensure this doesn't create a contagion effect in the market.
Okay, Bala.
Will this affect fund flows into fixed income funds as a whole? I mean, it's coinciding with advanced access time. It is coinciding with rising cost of capital, and so companies may have to encash their holdings in all kinds of fixed income funds.
Yeah.
So while all our data was on how equity is lower than the average,
correct,
will debt take a bigger hit that flows into debt funds?
No, it doesn't look like, because if you again look at the debt fund flows have been largely coming into the short duration funds,
yeah,
which is liquid funds to short duration funds, which invest up to about 3-year maturity. And second is inflows have been coming into the credit fund, where it's got a sufficient yield cushion in the form of portfolio yielding being higher. And as long as the exposure to these kind of instruments is just about 1 to 1.5% of your portfolio, so to the extent you'll have a valuation loss coming in the portfolio, but not going to erode your value significantly.
Okay.
So we have seen this cycle, I think 2013
yes,
was a period where we saw the worst actually for the bond market, and we overcome that pressure.
Yes, of course.
And we also seen in the last few years credit cycles going bad, and then the industry came across quite strongly.
Fair point.
So I think the industry will be able to manage that.
All right. Thank you very much, Bala, for dropping by and discussing fund flows into the mutual fund sector.
Thank you.
And by the way, the market is falling some more, so don't lose sight of that. Now down 230 points on the Sensex, and the Nifty is inching towards that 11,500 mark. So it's getting a bit ugly for the equity markets. Let's find out what's happening in the commodity space very quickly. Manisha Gupta joins in for a quick roundup of all the action there. Manisha, hi. Morning.
Morning, Sonia. Thank you so much for that. Well, the commodity markets for one are doing well. It is steady, stable in the global markets, and the rupee depreciation actually adds to the calculation on the higher side for many of these commodities. Starting with the crude oil prices, and more than a percentage point higher, it is 0.5% up because of what's happening in the global crude oil prices. And with the rupee nearly 0.8% down, that is the calculation that we're working with right now. Having said that, we did see 3% of decline in the crude oil prices in the previous week, but the downside is quite limited here because you have many strong fundamentals. To begin with, it is the Iran sanctions. And even as there is waivers being talked about for some countries, India, South Korea, Japan already have cut down on their Iran crude imports. Apart from that, the hedge funds' bullish positions also have continued to grow on the lower side. We also have seen the China crude imports for the month of August gain up by 6.5%. So there is various reasons that you are looking at support in case of the crude oil prices there. The strength in US dollar index, almost at a three-week highs, hasn't really deterred the global precious metal prices. We have seen a bit of a strength continue there. And the Indian prices, of course, are just about flat to marginal in the green. And that is because of the rupee calculation yet again. In the industrial base metal prices, we have seen the rebar steel prices hold around two-week highs. There is output cut now actually happening on ground, and that has been supportive. That seems to be the spillover effect that you are seeing in the other base metal prices also. But leaving that apart, it really is about the China and U.S. Trade concerns that seems to be escalating. Markets also are soaking in the U.S. non-farm payroll data that has been on the positive side. An interest rate hike from U.S. Fed in this month is yet another thing that the markets will be watching very, very closely. But in the meanwhile, it's actually a sea of green that you have seen continue in the base metal prices. Ferrous and non-ferrous, both the sectors are trading in the positive in the Asian and the Indian markets there. Trading strategies, and we have them from Angel, which really is a buy call coming in for those commodities. For crude, they're expecting the prices to go up to 4,950. It's a buy in the metal space as well. They have chosen copper with targets of 427 onto that one.
The one stock that we're going to focus on now is Glenmark Pharma. It has hit a fresh 52-week high. It's got a marketing authorization in Germany for one of their asthma drugs. And the stock, in any case, has been doing well for the past many days. Ekta joins in now to give us more details on this recent announcement. Ekta, over to you.
Yes, absolutely, Sonia. Fresh 52-week high for Glenmark. And the news today has just added to the momentum. They have received approval for Seretide Acuhaler, which is basically the generic version of Seretide Acuhaler by GSK. To market it in Germany. Now, important because the entire German market does not have a generic version of this particular inhaler. And Glenmark is the first one to have received approval for this generic version in Germany and would be launching that. Now, if you just go by the market size in Germany for this particular inhaler, which is used to treat asthma as well as chronic respiratory diseases, it is around $200 million, $170 to $200 million. Based on competition, Glenmark can make anywhere between $20 to $30 million. And in terms of market share, there is expected to be one more launch, which is expected to take place probably from Sandoz. And based on the competition in the next 1 year and how that pans out, market share could range anywhere from 5% to 20%. Again, that would only depend on the kind of competition that they face. But nonetheless, positive news coming for Glenmark. European sales were up 35% in the previous quarter.
Okay, we can take all the positive news that you can give us, Ekta, because we're not getting too much of positive news on markets today. The dollar is more expensive. I always say that that is good. But today, the rupee is the poorest performing currency at a time when the Reserve Bank seems to have put in support. The government tried to talk up the rupee. The Reserve Bank walked the talk, as it were. And you still see the rupee at its cheapest vis-a-vis the dollar in its history. Bond yields have climbed back to 8.10. Remember, they started at 8.03 this morning from Friday's handover. And the stock markets are pretty much close to breaching the Friday low of, when I say stock markets, I mean the Nifty of 11,490. It came within a smidge of coming to 11,500. So we leave the markets in a slightly dicey and precarious note. Chartbusters will take it forward. Let's leave you